Welcome, everybody, to meeting number 10 of the '93-'94 season. At this time, we'd like to have the roll call by the town clerk.
Chairman Chappell?
Yep.
Counsel Cogswell?
Here.
Counsel Dahlbeck?
Here.
Counsel Jordan?
Yep.
Counsel Linnell?
Here.
Counsel Marvlin?
Here.
And Counsel McGlaughlin?
Here.
Please stand and join me in the pledge allegiance to the flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. At this time, we have a spot for a citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. Well, that's good. Minutes of the meeting number 9, '93-'94, held December the 13th, 1993. May I have a please, have a motion to accept?
I move to accept.
Second.
Thank you. All those in favor? Thank you. Seven, zero. Reports and correspondence, please. Anybody? Quiet over Christmas? One letter that I would like to read that came to our town planner, Maureen O'Meara. She's here now. The Department of Environmental Protection has notified her that they have reviewed the amendments to the Cape Elizabeth zoning ordinance as adopted on November the 8th, 1993, and received by the department on November 18th, 1993. The department finds the amendments to be substantially consistent with the requirements of the Mandatory Shoreland Zoning Act and therefore approves the amendments as adopted. I think that's great. Congratulations to the group that worked on it, and special thanks to Maureen O'Meara, our planner. Any other reports? Counsel McGlaughlin?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Couple of things to bring to, one for the council's attention, one for the public's attention. For the council, you had in front of you, you don't have the yellow paper because it was photocopied off mine. It's a notice of a special program of the Mayors and Chairs Association. It's a two-part program of, one will be a mock trial, which will be Thursday, the 20th, which is a week from this Thursday, at the courthouse. I think will be quite interesting. And then part two of the program will be Thursday, February 3rd, at Greater Portland Council of Governments, which will be going over a similar, if not the same, exercise, but doing it with, in a different format, looking at alternative dispute resolution instead of going to trial. I think will be interesting. You're all heartily invited to attend those programs. And I want to make the public aware that at the December council meeting, we approved the formation of the Thomas Jordan Trust Implementation Committee. There will be a notice about this in the Cape Courier that's coming out this Saturday, the 15th, I believe. And we would like applications for that committee back in by the 25th. This is the group that will recommend policies for distributing the resources from the Thomas Jordan Trust. And it's a very short-term committee. I know that does appeal to some people. We're asking that the findings come back to this council by May 1st. So I encourage people who might be interested to apply for that. You may get applications for it from the town clerk's office, from Debbie Ling. Thank you.
Thank you, Jen. Counsel Dahlbeck?
I'm not too sure this is appropriate at this time, but I would just like to say that we've had a few snowstorms during the past week or so. And I think the Public Works Department has done a commendable job in keeping the roads clear. And I was in the IGA the other day, right after the snowstorm, just the middle of the morning, there's one of the Public Works fellows who's in there who'd been up all night. Godfrey, he was more alert and awake and bright than I certainly was, and I think that's great, that type of spirit.
Thank you, Counsel Dahlbeck. I still have my mailbox, so I second that approval.
I haven't written yet.
Any other reports? Thank you. Public hearings tonight, we have two. The first one is regarding liquor license renewal public hearings, and it's under our item number 118. Let me read that to you, and then we'll open the public hearing. To consider a proposed amendment to the Commercial Licenses and Permits Ordinance regarding public hearings on renewal applications for liquor licenses and special amusement permits and take any necessary action. That is the item. To start that off, and give us how it got to the position that it is now, I'd like to ask Counselor McLaughlin to bring us up to date, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This is an item that the council looked at a couple of years ago, and we're looking at again. What we're proposing to do is for liquor and special amusement permits. If it's a new permit, there will be a public hearing. If it's a renewal application, the council will take public comment, but it will not have to be advertised as a public hearing, thereby saving the applicant about $200 and perhaps some emotional distress thinking that they have to go through a public hearing.
Thank you. The public hearing is hereby open. Is there anybody from the group that would like to come up to the microphone and give their name and their address and speak on this item? Seeing no movement, why, we'll have the public hearing closed, and we'll take up item number 118. I have a motion on number 118.
Mr. Chairman, I propose that we adopt the presented language stating that it is only for new permits that the council holds public hearings for liquor and special amusement permit applications.
I hear a second to that.
Second.
Thank you. Moved and seconded. Discussion? Counselor Coggeshall.
I just wanted to make one note that that we are amending paragraph 3 of under section 512.
It's third paragraph, not the second.
Right.
Good, thank you. Any other discussion? Councilor Nell.
I just had one comment. On paragraph 5-1-4, it says the municipal officers may, after public hearing, preceded by notice to the licensee and so forth, suspend or revoke. And I'm wondering if we need to add some language in there also to add something like, or after meeting of the town council, because if we don't have a public hearing per se, might that, could you suspend a license if you haven't had a public hearing?
I'll ask the manager to clarify that, if you might.
I think that should be determined by the town council on whether or not you want to hold a public hearing before you actually suspend a permit. The intent of this particular amendment really dealt with license renewals and the concept of forwarding them to the state.
I think the vote that we're going to take, as you say, is just on public hearings to give a new license or a renewal. I think we ought to leave section 5-1-4 alone myself. Let it read just as it is, because we're not voting on that one anyway. Any other discussion? Councilor McLaughlin.
I agree with what you said. I want to add just, I believe it's because there's a difference between a renewal and a suspension. If it was a renewal, we did not want to renew. I believe that's different than a suspension. Am I correct, Debbie, as far as you know?
Right, in the context that you're saying, yeah.
Okay.
Thank you. All those in favor of item 118, so signify, 7-0, thank you. Moving on to public hearing number 2. Item number 119, to consider proposed technical amendments to the zoning and subdivision ordinances and take any necessary action. Councilor Coggeshall, will you open that one up for us, please?
Yes. We also have present tonight our planner, Ms. Maureen O'Meara, if people have any questions. This is a result of several, possibly 2 years of work by the planning board, the beginning of the subdivision ordinance. These are technical amendments that address present practices and just bring the ordinance up to what is being done. In some cases, we have new policies which are being proposed, however, and these include increasing the inspection fee from 3% to 5% and reimbursing any remaining funds to the developer. The cost of the planning board engineer reviews has been shifted from the town to the applicant, and a time limit of 1 year has been set for site plan approvals, which also can be extended. The amendments have been circulated by to the department heads, and the proposed changes have been recommended by the town manager, public works director, town attorney, and engineer. We are adding new definitions building envelope, final approval, planning board decision, performance guarantee, and site improvement. Those are all under Section 16 of the subdivision ordinance. We're also making some changes under the zoning ordinance under Section 19.2.2 and subsequent sections, which substitute under 19.4.7D floor area of the structure for gross finished living area. We realize that these are reflect present practices, these amendments and these clarifications, and we know that we need to do and are planning to do an update on further perceived shortcomings in the ordinances. We have a zoning ordinance rewrite committee that is being developed. We also have appendices which need to be renumbered, relettered. New Appendix C was going to be the road classification, and a new Appendix D is the illustration of the farthest non-conforming setback.
Thank you. Now we'll open the public hearing on the technical amendments to the zoning ordinances. Anybody like to come up and speak on that? Very quiet out there tonight. We'll close the public hearing. We'll take up item 119 to consider proposed technical amendments to the zoning and subdivision ordinances to take any necessary action. May I have a motion, please? Councilor Coggeshall.
Mr. Chairman, I move that the proposed technical amendments to the zoning and subdivision ordinances be approved as presented.
I would second that motion.
Moved and seconded. Discussion. All those in favor?
Can I discuss?
Well, you want to be in a hurry and get it up there, or we're going to move right along. Go ahead. Councilor McLaughlin.
Thank you, John.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. One concern I have had expressed to me is the time frame for site plan being at 1 year. I believe previous to this it's been 2 years. Is that?
No limit.
It's been no limit.
It's okay. Been no limit.
It's been no limit. Yeah. All right. My response to somebody bringing up the concern was that, okay, that person apparently thought it was 2 years, and so did I, was that I believe through the work that both the process, especially the process review committee, is going to be doing in the very near future, and then the zoning ordinance rewrite committee will be doing, that applicants will see perhaps a more responsive time frame, if I can use that term, from the planning board as they go through the process. They will, and therefore having 1 year time frame on getting their site plan underway seems very reasonable. I think we're making, not only are we making a change here, we're making a change to potentially to how we go, applicants will be going through the process to some extent.
Just to further clarify that, the applicant can apply for an extension. So they're not locked into that one year time frame, and there is a process that is written in the amendments that explains how to do it.
And it's nice to have it clarified. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Pardon me. Any other discussion? Councilor Jordan.
Yes, I'd just like to point out something that looks kind of vague to me on page 4, where it speaks about the performance guarantee granted to the town shall be included in the amount of the performance guarantee, including possible legal fees. Now, the word possible there is, in my opinion, you could charge one guy legal fees and the other one not. Where do we draw the line, in my opinion, who you charge and who don't you?
Should we have Ms. Amira respond to that?
When a performance guarantee is put together, typically what happens is the applicant will do an estimate of all the site improvements that are needed to be done, such as grading, road construction, installation of utilities. That list is reviewed by the town engineer. He recommends an amount, which is then reviewed and approved by the town manager. What I believe this clause has been used for in the past is that typically an applicant will get out there and start some work, but at some point may not complete all of the work. And that if you have done some of it, theoretically, you don't need the full amount of the performance guarantee if the town has to call the performance guarantee and complete the subdivision. If you have to call the performance guarantee, there usually are some legal fees involved, and you can use any extra amounts in the letter of credit to pay for those legal fees. So there really is, as far as I have never seen a legal fee built into the performance guarantee. Instead, what usually happens is if something goes wrong and you have to call the letter of credit, you can use any monies in the letter of credit to pay for those costs incurred by the town.
I still don't quite understand how it would, to me it would affect one and not the other.
It only would affect people who had subdivisions that, one, the town had to call the letter of credit for some reason, and there was enough money in the letter of credit to do all of the site work plus a little bit extra to cover those legal costs. But legal fees has never been a line item in a performance guarantee. Most of the line items have to do with gravel, pavement, installation of utilities, landscaping, those kinds of issues.
So in your opinion, you feel the other language within this paragraph would cover anybody as far as charge and legal fees?
Right. It would only happen on the rear. I think, for example, in Elizabeth Farms, you use part of the performance guarantee to cover legal fees. But in the original estimate of the guarantee for Elizabeth Farms, there was no line item for legal fees.
Okay, thank you.
Other discussion? All those in favor?
Wait a minute.
Seven, six.
Oh, all those you opposed? Have another question over there.
No. I was ready to vote. Okay.
Hesitation marks.
Yeah.
Can we have that vote again?
I won't say.
I didn't see all the hands that time. All those in favor? 7-0. That's better. Let's get them up there. Item number 120, to consider a proposed pay classification plan and take any necessary actions. Mr. McGovern.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. This pay classification plan comes before the town council, actually for the second time this evening. You earlier looked at it at a workshop meeting. It was prepared over the course of 6 or 7 months through 8 or 9 drafts with the help of all of the department heads, with review of the Personnel Advisory Committee, and with some help from Councillor Dalbeck as well, who provided some editing and other critique throughout the process, which was much appreciated. The pay plan involved looking at a number of different communities which were felt to be comparable to Cape Elizabeth, then comparing our wages and salaries with those other communities. We then developed a number of guiding principles, a specific pay plan, and some recommendations. Primarily, this provides that pay levels should be fair and they should be equitable, that pay should be based on performance and competency, that we should seek to attract and retain above average employees, and that we should therefore pay above the average of comparable communities for appropriately experienced personnel. It does not, however, define what is above average. It indicates that the pay plan should remain in effect for 3 to 5 years, and that each year the town council ought to have a pool of funds whereby it would determine how much should go in for salary and wage adjustments in a given year. Any salaries of folks that report to department heads would have to be reviewed by me. Anyone that reports directly to me, I would meet with the chairman of the council and the chairman of the finance committee so that they could see any changes occurring prior to their occurring. I would be happy to answer any questions you may have, but again, want to thank all of those who worked on preparing this pay classification plan.
Thank you, Mr. McGovern.
If I might add one other thing, there's been a whispering, people wondering where the cameras are this evening. There are two new cameras that are fully operating, and this is being broadcast despite the absence of.
I have assumed that the eyes of Cape Elizabeth were upon us.
That's good.
Mr. Chairman.
Okay, now?
I'm all set.
Okay. Thank you.
Can
we have the item and then we'll have discussion?
Yes, sir.
Or would you like to have questions now? Go ahead, Mr.
No. No, I'll wait until.
Okay. We'll have the chance to question him all you want, don't worry.
I would like to make a motion that the pay plan be approved, noting that does not include necessarily the items which are budget items later on related to the cost of implementation. I think those are strictly budget items, but otherwise that the basic pay plan be approved.
Second motion.
Moved and seconded. Now discussion. Phil, you have a question for the manager?
Yes. Number three on page two. It says cable industry should seek and attract and retain above-average employees. Just explain that a little bit, can we, how you figure out above-average, whether somebody walks in off the street for a job, you got to figure out whether he's above-average or not, is in talking to him. Is that the idea of this?
He or she.
He or she, excuse me. I'm sorry.
I think it's primarily a function of looking at experience and looking at professional reputation. Folks that come in that have a good track record of working in other localities for the private sector and that are experienced are the people generally who we would like to attract. Once in a while, we will start off with someone with a little less experience, and those folks will be paid below the average. But generally, we'll be looking for employees with more experience, and those are the ones that, particularly over time, we would hope to compensate above average.
Thank you.
I'd just like to build on that slightly. I think our objective should be to have employees who, in general, which does not mean everybody, by the way, are above average. When you hire a new employee, I don't think unless you have an unusual circumstance that you really are looking for some extraordinary skills, you necessarily look to hire at an above-average wage rate. But if that person proves out to end up being above average, you should be willing to compensate accordingly, and that is without defining exactly what above-average means. The question has been raised, how do you know they're above average? And I guess I'm back to if it looks like one, talks like one, and acts like one, it is one. But I better do all three.
Thank you, Councilor. Councilor Martin?
I'm very uncomfortable with item three on page two. I agree that we should seek to attract and retain above-average employees, and I think probably we checked with other communities, Falmouth, Cumberland, Yarmouth, wherever, they would all say that they also seek to attract and retain above-average employees. I think setting up a guiding principle that says we therefore are going to pay above-average is just a bad way to go about things. I'm very uncomfortable with that thought, and therefore I'll be voting against the motion.
Any other discussion? Councilor McLaughlin.
One reason I'm going to be supporting this is basically because of the guiding principles that have been set out. I think we've got some very good basis here for how we're going to be dealing with the pay situation. I'm particularly pleased to see the words that pay will be based on performance and competency. I know that it's sometimes difficult to achieve, but I'm glad we're trying for it. I appreciate the work that's gone into this to get us to that point.
Thank you. Councilor Coggeshall.
Yes, I want to make sure I understand correctly that this pay that is going to be the added incentive for performance will not be considered part of the base pay the following year. That this is a gratuity that's given to them that goes up and down, but it's not going to be added on necessarily.
The general intent of this is that it would become part of the base pay, which is not to say that in a succeeding year, if someone is not performing up to standards, there is the possibility for a reduction. I, quite frankly, don't see that there would be one.
No, I
think you're right, Bill, but certainly there are employees who might be kept still at a given point. But generally, you don't reduce pay. It hasn't really been discussed, but at the times when this comes up during the budget process, there will be a pool of funds available. I have not said necessarily that all of that money would go directly into pay. There would be potential with council authority you know, or particularly with those that are reviewed by the finance chairman and the council chairman, to have certain performance awards for a particular project, something like that. If someone's working on a particular project for a year, and, you know, that project might be, not be around a second year, you might, I might in that instance say that this amount is a performance award for this particular year, is not part of the base pay. But I wouldn't want to leave you with the impression that that is going to be the norm. That will happen at times, and I would like the flexibility to do that, particularly in succeeding years.
That was my impression, that this would be a one-time thing and not necessarily a foundation for the following year. I think that's getting us locked into to perhaps higher wages and escalating wages if we can't, if we increase each one of them by yearly by the annual rate. And they're not all starting at the same level. I think we're just, and then you add on the extra compensation year after year.
Councilor Dahlbeck?
Thank you. This was not meant to be, in any discussions Mike and I have had, a bonus plan per se. And I think before we went into a bonus plan, we'd like to think of all of the you know, factors and the pluses and minuses that can go with a bonus plan, because there can be many pluses and minuses. I would hope, though, that it was a plan that if we said somebody, whomever it might be, John or Jane Doe, seemed to be operating, you know, was operating and deserved something above average, and that is not, with the amount of money we're playing with, going to be some big gargantuan differential. That in the following year, if Jane or Joe Doe is coasting on their previous laurels, there's nothing I would rather see than the message go across, which is no increase, which would probably put them right back where they were before they had that. And that no increase is definitely possible. There's one comment I would like to make on this. Mike has used the word cost of living adjustment. I do not like, and that was in the implementation part of the plan. I do not like the phrase cost of living adjustment per se, because I think it has some connotations that you know, mean that it's almost due. It's basically an adjustment to keep our salary ranges consistent with those of the marketplace. So if, you know, if everybody else is going up at X percent, you'd want to, if we had following our marketplace orientation, to go up a certain percent, which may or may not have anything to do with whatever has happened to the CPI.
Thank you. Any other discussion? Councilor Noel.
On item three, perhaps ideally, you know, language might say something about we should therefore expect to pay competitive salaries, that kind of thing. I think that may reflect Councilor Dahlbeck's comments that we'd have to be competitive in the marketplace. Ideally, not necessarily above average or high, but competitive. My understanding was that this plan was not a bonus plan per se in discussions. This was something that went with the pay. Therefore, you'd have to be very careful about adding to it. I think on paragraph number four, that ideally, the last word in the first line, you know, the word may could be substituted for should. Should sort of implies that some sort of annual increase or adjustment, and I think that would depend on the economy and the market.
Excuse me, go back over where that is.
I'm sorry, paragraph four, the first line, this pay plan should remain in effect for 3 to 5 years and should be annually adjusted. I think ideally it would say, and may be annually adjusted. It's not a word that would make me vote against this. I'm just, I think that would reflect some of the spirit of what we're talking about. It would leave the option open. I don't feel that it's, you know, anything to split hairs over, but...
Other discussion? All quiet.
I just want to say that I agree with the pay plan part of it goes, but I don't want to be hung at a later date by saying, because I vote for this whole package, that I agree with all these guidelines. And toying with my mind now whether to vote for or against, because I don't agree with these guidelines, not all of them. And I think you have some good points there, and I'm willing to pay the guy that does the job and is qualified and works above average. But I don't like to see it wide open so everybody ends up above average.
Councilor Linnell.
Well, I think ultimately we know how we feel about this, and it says guiding principles. I don't think it's not cast in bronze that we have to do anything on here. These are just sort of general ideas, and so I wouldn't want to be boxed in, but I ultimately, having said what I have to say about it, I don't feel that we'd be absolutely held to these principles.
Thank you. Councilor Jordan.
Well, I just want to bring it up for some time at a later date. Some little things might come back to haunt you, and this is one of the possibilities.
Since you are likely to have the 1-for-1 approval of those people reporting to Michael, I rest very comfortable.
Are you ready for the question? All those in favor of item number 120, raise the right hand. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. All against. 6-1. Thank you. Item 121. To consider modifying the pay plan for the fire department volunteers and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern, please.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. You have before you this evening a new pay plan that was developed by a pay plan committee consisting of some officers and members, I guess, of Engine 1 and Engine 2 companies. You have on the dais here this evening the old pay plan. Chief McGoldrick is here this evening, and I'd like to ask him to come to the podium to briefly explain the difference between the old plan and the new plan, and anything else he might like to add.
excuse me. What's happened last year when we were involved in our Firefighter One training program, it became very evident to all the members that the more time that you spent, the less compensation you were going to receive. And it worked adversely on personnel that couldn't attend that training but were still considered very valuable members of the fire department. What happened was that during the Firefighter One training, they spent over 120 hours of training. If you couple that with approximately 30 to 50 hours of fire time, that meant that they were getting 100 and 150 hours. If they maxed out at that $275, you can see that they were receiving somewhat less than $1.50 an hour. In the reverse, what happened is the personnel that didn't have the time, and maybe had been on the fire department for a long time, didn't have the time to participate in the training, but did make a lot of the fire calls, their percentage, and this is what the old pay plan was based on, their percentage of attendance was so low that they ended up making about $1 an hour. So it worked against us in both situations. There was a lot of talk amongst the members of the department about the problems, and I suggested to them that we get together a committee and take a look at the pay plan that we're presently using and see if that's what they wanted to continue using or whether they had some suggestions on something else that we should look at. We rounded it out with some of the old timers, if you will, and some of the younger guys, officers and privates and so forth. We took a look at what history they could give me of the pay plans in the past. We also sent out a survey to communities, starting with Biddeford and going up to Wyndham and over to Cumberland, back down to Freeport, and everything in between that had call company personnel, and we got what they were doing. We put all this information together with the committee, and the committee voted to send to you people and the companies the pay plan that you presently have before you, with the understanding that last year the town council had given additional funding to the part-time personnel account, and they wanted the firefighters wanted the council to know that they were very happy with the total compensation that was being allowed. They just wanted good distribution of the resources that were the town council was giving. And so they said that if the total number of hours on an hourly rate exceeded the pay that the town council has allowed for this year, even extending that into the following year, in other words, ask no adjustment in the total part-time personnel account, that they would live with whatever that money was. And if in the spring of the following year from now that the hours exceeded that amount of money that was there, they would percentage the amount of money, they would go back and they would percentage the amount of money that was in that account, because they wanted you to know that they appreciated the money there, and the only thing that they're trying to do in this particular case is be paid for the hours that they attend training and the hours that they go on fire calls.
Thank you, Chief. Any questions for the Chief?
Help me understand this maybe a little bit more, Phil. Would this money be dispersed weekly or monthly throughout the year so that I might completely run out of money, let's say, in the third quarter?
The money would be dispersed exactly the way it's dispersed now. It would be dispersed in the wintertime in December and in the summertime in June. So the pay periods, there would still be two pay periods as there has been in the past. Now in the December payroll, there's no doubt in anybody's mind in the December payroll that the money would be enough resources there to pay those people an hourly rate for their training and their call company time. My honest belief is, looking at the records, that in the June payroll, the same would hold true. But just so that the council is assured that that account would not run over, the people agreed that if for some reason in that second pay period in June, if the hourly rate caused the remaining money for that budgetary year to run over, they would reduce on a percentage basis to the number of hours that they had so that it would not run over.
You're fairly comfortable that this would not create a situation by which somebody racked up a lot of hours training or otherwise the first half of the year, and this got well compensated, and then the second half of the year there wasn't enough money there to be compensated?
I feel comfortable that that would not happen.
That you're going to have good balance?
Yes.
Any other questions for the Chief? Thank you very much, Chief.
Thank you.
Item 121, to consider modifying the pay plan for fire department volunteers and take any necessary action. May I have a motion, please?
I certainly think a motion ought to be on the table. I would move the recommendation of the fire department.
Thank you.
I'll second it.
Discussion? Councilor McLaughlin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have a question for the manager, I guess is the best person. We had something in the packet and we had something tonight. I'm seeing numbers that are confusing me. Under the payroll, what's before us tonight, we're right now in fiscal year 94. Is that $6 an hour?
No.
No.
That's 600 per year.
600 per year. Okay. So instead of basically, instead of 600, instead of an annual salary, they'd be getting an hourly salary.
That's right.
What I'm understanding.
They're really switching to, instead of stipend personnel, they're more call personnel. Is that the right term? On-call, yeah. Call firemen, but they're still volunteers.
Okay.
I have to be careful with that terminology. I don't want to offend anyone, but we think of them as volunteers.
The counselors think of themselves as volunteers, we're hoping.
Any other discussion?
Thank you.
Counselor Marvin?
So it comes down to that, the same amount of money would be spent, it's just going to be given to the firefighters in different ways.
Go ahead.
I'm convinced that if it doesn't come out close to the budget over time will be adjusted to see that it does. The volunteers aren't going to be happy for very long if as Counselor Dalbec points out, they realize they're working for nothing in May and June. And, if that begins to be the case, there's going to be pressure awfully quick to adjust the budget in the succeeding year to make sure it will cover the full 12 months.
Counselor Jordan?
But as I understand this pay plan, that if they have to be a light year as far as fires go, if there's any money left of the $40,000, it comes back to the kitty for the town?
Back to the town's general fund, just as it does now.
Thank you.
Any other discussion? All those in favor? 7-0, thank you. Item number 122, to consider the acceptance of a $9,375 grant from the Maine Waste Management Agency to promote backyard composting and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern, please.
Yes, as you can see, some people hire grant writers to make real fancy grant applications, and Cape Elizabeth is indeed fortunate that we have volunteers who are willing to put in quite a bit of time to prepare grant applications. And in this instance, it was Joanne Daigle, who's the chairman of the Recycling Committee, who, as you can see, put in a lot of time really thinking through and I think really impressed the state that this is a project that has community support and is not just some staff member in the office with fancy word processing coming up with all sorts of ideas, and that definitely had to impress the state. What this grant would do is provide quite a bit of education in the area of composting. It would help to supply citizens with backyard composting bins, and in the long run is environmentally appropriate and could save the town quite a bit in the area of disposal cost with leaves, yard waste, and some food waste as well. I would like to ask that you approve the acceptance of the funds. The $3,125 local match would come from the existing account that has about $3,400, $3,500 left in it for recycling activities, and that you designate me as the project manager for the filing of reports with the state and the request for funds as well.
Thank you, Mr. McGovern. May I have a...
Mr. Chairman,
I'm sorry, go ahead.
I move, as the manager has suggested, that we accept the $9,375 grant. We approve the expenditure of $3,125 from the existing account, and we designate the manager as the project manager.
A second.
Moved and seconded. Discussion? All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you.
I think we should owe Joanne Daigle a very large vote of thanks on this. She did an absolutely terrific job.
Tremendous job.
And I want one of those bins.
Oh, it is. Quite professional. Maureen wants to be careful. Item number 123, to consider clarifying a right-of-way at Lions Field and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern, please.
Excuse me, Mr. Chairman.
Oh, yeah. Counselor Linnell.
Yes, I'll step down for this.
Mr. Chairman, what you have before you this evening is a clarification of a right-of-way that has apparently existed over Lions Field for quite some time. Mr. William Linnell came in to see me a couple years ago indicating that he felt he had a right-of-way to some the lot or lots he owned at the time up at the rear of Lyons Field. When he came in, I was a little bit unsure as to whether or not there was in fact a right-of-way that existed, and encouraged Mr. Linnell to seek competent legal counsel to actually look at the title and to provide a title opinion to the town on whether or not a right-of-way existed. Mr. Linnell subsequently did retain counsel. Don Philbrick, a well-known title attorney in the area, who's very familiar with Cape Elizabeth titles, did provide a title opinion to the town attorney for his review, and Mr. Leahy felt as well that these lots at the rear of Lyons Field were entitled to a right-of-way over Lyons Field. Then we next came to the issue as to, so there's a right-of-way, where shall it be? It was felt that it was really in the town's best interest, and perhaps as well of the present and future property owners at the rear of Lyons Field, that the right-of-way be defined, because the original deed way back did not provide any exact location of the right-of-way. So we worked with Mr. Linnell and with his attorney to determine an exact location of the right-of-way that was advantageous to the town first, and secondarily to Mr. Linnell. This does provide that there would be a 40-foot right-of-way extending out from Ocean House Road, Route 77, along the existing driveway that's now there to the spot where there's a bit of a gate. It would then extend all the way from that point to the lot line of the lots benefited by the right-of-way at the very end of the town's property. This does indicate that the town intends, as the grantor, to maintain and remove snow for the first 750 feet of the right-of-way, which is about to the end of the Little League field. However, it does not in any way obligate us to do that, that we're doing that for our benefit, and if we have a C-Star activity, there's no guarantee to the holders of the right-of-way that would necessarily occur forever. This also, this indenture before you requires that any other rights that Mr. Linnell and the other individuals involved have are released into this right-of-way, that this is their right-of-way from this point in time on. The indenture also provides that it in no way grants expressly or implied any other rights, and that any approvals for use of the property, public access waivers, or whatever else is required, is solely the responsibility of Mr. Linnell and the other parties to obtain, that the town does not grant any special rights, and really that they're on their own as far as obtaining those necessary permits. It provides that we can keep the utility shed within the right-of-way, that it is not an encroachment. However, I do want to make clear that it is my intent to move that utility shed to a more permanent location outside the right-of-way. That was just placed there last fall when it originally been placed in an area that was within the wetland buffer, and we're still seeking a permanent home for that on the site that's not in the right-of-way and outside the wetland buffer area. In addition, I would like to mention that another issue came up is that should the property owner in the rear obtain the clarification of this right-of-way and obtain the other public access waiver permits, it's my understanding that Mr. Linnell may want to move a home to the rear across this property. Mike Hill, who works with the town attorney, mentioned it to me this afternoon, in fact, and I indicated to him that at this point in time, I did not want to muddy up the waters, I'll quote myself directly, by trying to define that this evening. The issue was, would Mr. Linnell and the other owners have the right to take a house over that property? It'd be my intent to work with them to achieve that goal, provided the other permits are obtained, but I didn't want to do anything this evening that would in any way totally tie it down, so then anyone come back to me and say, well, you said you'd do this, when whenever we look at moving large structures in town, there are other issues that need to be looked at. Between 4:30 this afternoon, when I spoke to Mr. Hill and this evening, there just wasn't time to resolve that. But I did want you to know that it's my intent to try to clarify that issue separate and apart from this, with the intent, should the other permits be available, of giving permission to have this the home traverse over this right-of-way. One other thing I do want to mention is you do have a slightly different document before you this evening than was mailed to you on Friday, and I was studying it, trying to figure out the difference. And if you look at the indenture on the page 1 of 3, the only difference in this, and this is an example of attorneys and how carefully they review things, the original copy said, witness my hand and seal this blank day of January 1994. The new draft says, and witness whereof the grantor has caused this indenture to be executed this blank day of January 1994. And that's the difference of what you have before you this evening compared to what you received in the mail over the week.
Thank you for clarifying that.
Took me a while to find it.
I've been looking for some.
We have a motion on this item. Councilor Coggeshall.
But before we move, I want to bring up a topic, because I know in executive session we discussed certain items that we wanted to be addressed, and we had a feeling it was going to come back so we could discuss it as council. And I still see a couple of things that are not in this agreement that I thought we wanted to include. We could possibly table this and take it up in our executive session tonight, where we're dealing with properties, and then set it for a special town council meeting just before our workshop in 2 weeks, if we wanted to deal with it and have a discussion there. That's one solution, one way of handling this. I don't know how critical this time frame is to you, Mr. Linnell.
Well,
you're not due before a board, really, for another month, really, are you? This wouldn't.
I don't know what you're talking about. You know, what you're referring to is how to be a
The two items that I have in mind, but one in particular that I wanted to see included, is in paragraph 3 that begins notwithstanding, and you go down to the last full sentence where it talks about for maintenance or snow plowing, and I would like to see inserted or improvement of any portion of the right of way hereby conveyed. Which would mean that if that road needed to be improved or expanded to meet any standards, that expense would be totally yours and not the town in any way. And that would just clarify that point.
I don't have a problem with that. I intend to improve the portion from the tool shed, so to speak, on anyway. I intend to submit a profile of the road as it is and so forth.
Right, but this is, I'm also talking about the 750-foot strip as well, that if any improvement would needed to be done of that strip by you in order to gain town your building permit, that would be part of your expense and not any of the town expense, because as the road exists now, it meets all our needs.
Well, I don't know if the town planners, I can't imagine that it would. I mean, I don't have a problem with it.
No, I'm just saying, I just want to have it clear that the town wouldn't be responsible for helping with the expense of that kind of an improvement.
If I may, that certainly has been the discussion, that as a result of granting this clarification of this easement, that, you know, we wouldn't bear any obligation for any requirement that anyone benefited by this right-of-way might have to bear.
You know, so that we just actually have it in black and white.
Yeah, has anyone made a motion to approve this?
No.
Yeah, that could be something that language could be added in. I could have the town attorney, type up a new one with that language in it. Well, we could do it here.
Well, I think we could do it here, and then we could just insert it. We wouldn't need to deal it again. And there was one other item here, which is sort of secondary. If there was going to be any requirement by the town for a portion of the expense of plowing, even if we did it ordinarily, would there be a contribution from the property owners towards that plowing?
I haven't specifically, I can't say legally what was said in the executive session, but I will say that I haven't specifically instructed anyone to insert that language in.
Okay, I know it's a common process when people do share a driveway, that a portion of the expenses too are carried by the people who go across it to their own property. I didn't know if that had been discussed between the town attorney and your attorney.
He told me to resist that.
I'm sure.
I would point out.
Let's be honest.
I would point out that any use that I have over that road would be, I think, minimal compared to the traffic that is on it. Further, I'd point out that when I improve the road from the tool shed to the woods, at considerable expense, that road, although I will have a right-of-way over it, it will essentially become the property of the town. It seems that I'll be spending a small fortune to improve that road when there's a Little League game, even when there isn't a Little League game, over that first 700 feet, there's considerable traffic there.
Seasonal traffic, yeah.
And I can't imagine that, and for that matter, if I am successful and I live there, I will be going over about 4 miles less of town roads when I go home, when I go there, than when I go home today, tonight. So
that's your choice, right?
Yeah. Well, I'm just saying that I'm not looking forward to getting my first tax bill if I am successful in putting a house there, and I would think that would ought to cover it.
Councilor Dahlbeck.
From what little I know of rights of way, and I have been involved in another community with a bit of a right-of-way discussion, I guess we'd call it, dispute maybe, an individual cannot, who has a right-of-way, cannot unilaterally improve that right-of-way without permission of the landowner. I think that's right, which may get into the fact that we do need something more on this, but the way Bill is talking, he's talking about improving it. I don't think having a right-of-way over somebody's land gives you a right to do anything more than maintain its passability.
Yeah. I have not had specific...
And I think that just ought to be clarified, among other things.
Yeah. In the capacity as property owner, I have not had any specific discussions with Mr. Linnell or any of his representative in terms of exactly how they're going to improve it. I am aware that Mr. Linnell needs to go through a planning board process, and with my property hat owner's representative hat on, my reaction is, let's see how you go before those boards and then come back and get permission to do whatever it is that you want to do.
I just think we need to make sure that is clear. That type of wording I don't think typically shows up in a right-of-way quitclaim deed or anything, but it I think is almost by statute or by case law or something, it says that. And the lawyer sits to my left.
Councilor Coggeshall.
I move that we get the correct wording here. Approve the clarification of a right-of-way at Lyons Field as presented with one amendment. That in paragraph 3 that we include after for the maintenance or snow plowing or improvement of any portion of the right-of-way here conveyed.
I would second that motion.
All Moved and seconded. Discussion.
Could I hear the motion again, please? Could I hear the last part of your motion?
The last part of my motion is in the third paragraph to insert in the next to the last sentence, where it says maintenance or snow plowing, to insert or improvement of any portion of the right-of-way hereby conveyed. This is referring back to the town having the responsibility for it.
If I may, Mr. Chairman, so what you're saying there is, if I understand it, that Mr. Linnell is going to have to improve that 750 feet to your satisfaction, the town of Cape Elizabeth. Is that correct?
It goes, if there needs to be an improvement, he would be the one responsible, not the town.
And the town is, by using that first 750 feet, which would, in my opinion, create more traffic than Mr. Linnell would in a year. They would create more traffic in one summer and one winter over that. And he's going to be responsible to fix that road to your specifications or your satisfaction. Is that the way I understand this motion?
In this particular paragraph, it makes reference that the town does not have to be responsible for maintaining it or snow plowing it. It's not obligated, and we're inserting or not obligated for any improvement.
So the town isn't responsible for it as far as him crossing it. Is the town responsible for the plowing if he was away to get into the ice skating, or is he going to provide it?
No. We are going to do all of the plowing and all of the routine maintenance up to on the first 750 feet. Okay. That is the town's clear intent. We've always done it. We have 1,000 trips compared, well, maybe that's the site. We have 300 trips compared to the one or two trips for the property benefited at the end. There's no intent to wait for anyone else to do that. That is our plan. However, what we don't want to be in the position is that, say we have a huge blizzard, this is last on our list. We don't want Mr. Linnell or any of the other property owners to be calling us saying, I want my driveway plowed. You know, we're going to put this in the regular priority like it is everything else, and, you know, if he wants to go in and plow it, you know, he can do that as long as he doesn't damage it, he or anyone else that eventually owns the land up there. What this really is getting at, I think, is if during the public access review, say the planning board said that he needed to pave so many feet in, that would be his responsibility, and the town would not share in that. If something came up as a result of, you know, a specific requirement for some permit he might get from the regulatory side of the town, which is different than what the town's had on as a property owner. There's a different role for us.
Okay, I understand the way you explained it, but I don't understand her language, because I think the language that Councillor Cogshaw read there is putting the responsibility on the property owner to go over that first 750 feet. And I agree with what the manager said. If I know that's a low priority as far as being plowed out, and if he wanted to get in and out beforehand, he'd be responsible for it. But I don't think he's responsible for it if he was away and there's a storm that somebody would have to, under his bailiwick, have to plow that out so the town people could get in to go ice skating with him.
Oh, no.
They would have that responsibility.
No, that's not the intent.
Any other discussion?
I don't agree with it.
Councilor McLaughlin.
Another clarification, please, relating to, let's go with the snow plowing, since it's that time of year. The town will plow. When the town plows over there, it'll plow only the first 750 feet. Is that correct?
We will plow that portion that benefits the Little League and the ice.
Probably the ice.
This is gone. You know, I'm not sure, you know, that one concern we have is exactly where that gate is.
Yeah.
And, you know, where do we dump snow at that point?
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's the intent to stop there, but if we needed to go a little further, a little less, in order to ease getting rid of the snow so we don't leave a big block of snow at the end, you know, my hope is we could work with the property owners at the rear to work those issues out over time. I wouldn't want to be tied to exactly 750 feet. The intent is for the town only to plow that area that benefits our uses there.
Is the rest of the right-of-way past the first 750 or so feet public or private access?
It is still town-owned land. The property owners in the rear merely are given the right to improve it, to maintain it, and to use it.
Thank you.
Councilor Jordan.
I just have one other question according to this map here. That six-foot chain link fence, is that to be at the end of it so nobody can continue on to the other property? Or does that mean that it's going to be a...
That's no longer there.
Oh, excuse me. I'm correct.
That's something that someone else had put there. It's not there anymore.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Was there a second to Councilor Coggeshall's motion? There was.
There was.
Moved and seconded. Any other discussion? All those in favor of the motion? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Six? And Bill wasn't here, so that's unanimous. Thank you. You can come back now, Councilor Nell. Item number 124, to consider the acceptance of Meadowview Lane, at the Meadowview subdivision off Mitchell Road and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern, please.
Yes, Cape Elizabeth's newest public road would be Meadowview Lane under this proposal. Meadowview Lane is located off Mitchell Road across from Stonegate Lane. It's part of a subdivision approved about 4 or 5 years ago, but within the last year taken over by Larry E. Lydon Jr. Construction, Inc. They've built a very fine road there. It is ready for acceptance. It has been fully inspected, along with a drainage easement that is at the end of the cul-de-sac and a pedestrian easement that was reviewed during the planning board process and now is being formally offered to the town. Earlier, the town council looked at all these and agreed to accept them once they were built satisfactorily, and this is the final acceptance, which means that we would begin plowing the road and being responsible for it.
Thank you. May I have a motion?
Mr. Chairman, I'll move that we accept Meadowview Lane at Meadowview subdivision off Mitchell Road.
I'll second that motion.
Moved and seconded. Discussion. Councilor Coggeshall.
I just want to verify that they do meet all the current standards or past standards.
Those standards are such a moving target. They met all the ones they're required to meet.
At the time that it was approved.
I would presume so. I really can't answer that one.
I'm sure our planning board may go through the necessary votes.
There is a real minor issue of a little bit of grading around some manholes, and we're holding $500 out of the performance bond. Actually, they're going to give us $500 to cover that, but you know, Mr. Lydon's very responsible and good to work with, and he's waiting patiently so he can dump this road onto the town.
He doesn't have to plow next week.
Other discussion? All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you. Item number 125, to consider acknowledging receipt of the capital improvement plan for fiscal years 1995 through 1999 and take any necessary action. Mike? Mr. McGovern, please.
Yes. I would first like to say this does not obligate you to anything. Underlined exclamation point. Two, I think it's very interesting that the format we did was a little bit different in that for the first 3 years, the wish list was pared down to some more realistic amounts. For example, next year's budget provides that the capital improvement plan section of it would be essentially the same amount as this year. The numbers under manager's recommendation for fiscal year 95 are still subject to some review as we work on the budget a little bit more, but it's a pretty good indication of where the budget will be for capital improvements this coming year. Would like to thank all the department heads for their work on this, and something we enjoy doing every year. And yeah, I think there's a number of interesting things in here. One is for the first time in a long time, there's a proposed new vehicle equipment replacement schedule for the fire department, something we haven't seen in quite a bit of time, and I think it is a good plan. There's also more lease purchase, as had been recommended by the Service Delivery Option Committee during their deliberations a couple of years ago. And there's also an interesting recommendation on Fort Williams Park, which can be part of the debate as that issue evolves during 1994. So I would encourage you to acknowledge receipt of this as a planning guide.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Discussion. Councilor Dalbec.
Query. This is either something that should be discussed at some time or put in a round file. Which are we going to do?
My desire is, if you, somewhere, I don't know if you've received it yet or if it's up in your boxes, is a proposed budget plan for this coming year, budget schedule. And within that, it provides that you'd spend an evening, thank you, you'd spend March 28th in the evening reviewing this.
Reviewing this specifically?
This, and with its slight amendments, you know, that might be between now and then.
No, that's good, because there are some things that aren't in here that states are not in here, which means we ought to have maybe a little better picture as we look out.
Yeah, there's one particular issue, the public safety building needs, that I'm not ready to recommend anything specific until I'm comfortable recommending something. Mm-hmm. I'm just not too sure what the answer is yet there, so, but I, it is hinted here that there may be some cost recommended for that, but I'm not sure exactly what it is yet. One of those things I didn't want to cast in concrete. And, you know, so often, particularly Councilor Jordan, will query me on, does this mean we're obligated to do it? And it was something that I didn't want to have come back on me that this is what you said you were going to do, and I'm not really comfortable not knowing what I would like to have us do yet.
No comment.
He's not obligating himself.
All those in favor of acknowledging receipt of the capital improvements plan, so signify, 7-0, thank you. Item 126, to consider changing the March meeting of the Town Council from Monday, March 14th, 1994, to Wednesday, March 16th, 1994, take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern.
Yes, there's a meeting obligation that interferes with Monday, March 14th, that involves two councilors and myself. It's been traditional when that meeting, when that conflict happens, as it often does in March, to change the meeting to another date that's mutually convenient, and it's required that that be done at a council meeting according to the council rules, that whenever you change the regular meeting, it needs to be publicly voted upon.
I would move the change.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor? 7-0. Thank you. Item number 127, to consider entering into executive session to review two applications for poverty abatements, to begin the annual evaluation of the town manager, to discuss land acquisition, disposition, and take any necessary action.
So moved.
Second. All those in favor? We are going into executive session. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, will we be adjourned after executive session's over and not coming back here for the public?
Yes, we will be adjourning after the end of the executive session. That's right.